Wow, the video about Masato's Google Search XSS was the most shared video I have ever made. I'm really happy that so many people appreciate the ingenuity in it, even though many people would say it's just an XSS. So I thought we could talk about how Masato found this XSS and use it as an example for how security research can look like. Maybe you can also start doing some research yourself. Let's first start with a tweet Gareth shared in 2017 about a very similar weird behavior he noticed, which basically looks like Masato's XSS, just with no embed. At that time, Mike West also responded that NoScript works too. You should know that Mike West is heavily involved in the World Wide Web Consortium, W3C, so he's a person who has real influence on the web, and so he wrote about NoScript that this is what the spec says about should happen, but I wonder if we should change that. So Mike West and Gareth found this kind of behavior interesting back in 2017. Gareth actually found that no embed mutation when researching Cloudflare's HTML parser. You can read more in the blog post over at Portswigger. Masato then also responded to Gareth's tweet saying, "I often use this trick when I attack any server-side sanitizer." That's what I was saying last video about server-side sanitation. The problem is that there could be parser differentials between a server-side parser versus what the browser actually parses. And by the way, the idea of attacking different parser behaviors is a fundamental idea in IT security research. I have even made a video in 2016 introducing that concept as part of the binary exploitation playlist. So that kind of thinking during research is not uncommon. But Masato also added that, "I didn't know that the inconsistent state happens via JS APIs until recently. Did you know that?" So even though he's super experienced, he apparently didn't realize that parsing with JavaScript functions can also be different. So Masato has seen the browser and HTML parsers doing weird stuff all the time, and he told me that there were two behaviors that he has observed that ultimately led him to the discovery of the XSS. The first observation had to do with iframes. He said that a few years ago, he was testing and playing around with iframe sandboxing and the HTML NoScript tag. The sandbox applies extra restrictions to the content in the iframe. The value of the attribute can be empty to apply all restrictions. And as you see in the sandbox options, you could allow JavaScript in the iframe with allow script or if you didn't use a sandbox attribute at all. Which means in this case, with an empty sandbox attribute, the iframe content cannot execute JavaScript. As you can also see, there is a source doc attribute, which is inline HTML to embed. So this simply creates an iframe with this content. Let's copy that iframe and also allow scripts, and then we have a look at it in the browser. So here we have the two worlds, a world with JavaScript enabled and a world with JavaScript disabled. As we know since last video, this is what we expected the behavior of NoScript to be. If scripting is disabled, it parses HTML children nodes. If scripting is enabled, it will ignore anything in it, it's just unimportant text in this case. Why did he test that a few years ago? No clue. That's probably just the curiosity of a researcher asking himself, how does NoScript behave in a sandboxed iframe when scripting is disabled but the browser itself would support scripting? Anyway, we have one clue of the puzzle. The second puzzle piece is about something he observed in different HTML parsers. It turns out that there are many different ways you can let the browser parse HTML. One example would be the template element we learned about last episode, but there's also DOM parser. The DOM parser interface provides the ability to parse XML or HTML source code from a string into a DOM document. And here you can see the function parse from string to create a HTML document from a string. And there is also DOM implementation, create HTML document, which creates a new HTML document. He told me he was fuzzing the following pattern, tag A open, tag B open, tag B close, tag A close, and in between just some text so the HTML elements are not empty. Here is the actual test HTML site he wrote to fuzz this. When you go there, you see an iframe and it seems to cycle through the different tag combinations for the pattern. While this is running, let's peek into the code. Here is a huge list of possible tags, and here it creates the iframe. In the function test, he then creates dynamically an HTML document with create HTML document and prepares the HTML content with the fuzzing tags, and then he extracts the HTML from the document sdom1. After that, he loads an iframe URL, which basically just returns a document with whatever charset and content he wants. When the iframe is loaded and the onload triggers, he then extracts the HTML from the iframe and compares it to the previous DOM1. If they are different, they will print that. And when you let that run in Chrome, which takes a bit, eventually you will get some results. You will find no embed and no script to behave weirdly. Interestingly, if you run this in Firefox, you will find that math and SVG elements parse differently too. Masato actually also checked if that leads to a bypass of the DOM Purify Sanitizer, but this behavior was apparently already known and mitigated. Just to practice, I also created a fuzzer to test the same pattern, but using the DOM Parser API instead and overwriting my own document HTML. I won't go over the details of it, the idea is the same, you'll find the code in the description as well. Anyway, that runs super fast and it also finds a parser differential between DOM parser and the regular HTML document inner HTML parser. So we also found that parsers inside of the browsers can parse things differently. That's the good second puzzle piece Masato needed. Masato knows very well how DOM Purify works and he has a lot of general experience with this stuff. And so both observations together led him to realize that he might be able to abuse this different parsing to bypass the sanitation in DOM Purify. Here's another tweet I wanted to show. Koto from Google responded on Twitter to my video about Masato's XSS and wrote, "The funny thing is, we knew about that. It's a mutation XSS variant and we coded the sanitizer to block that vector. A crucial line of code was later removed during refactoring and we didn't catch this." Sir Darkhead, the Google person who fixed the XSS, also admitted shamefully, maybe some unit tests would have prevented that regression. And finally, that was unique is that Masato found bypasses for two different sanitizers, but with the exact same payload, ours and DOM Purify with different root causes. DOM Purify does MXSS protection differently. That blew our mind. Kudos. So you see, other researchers actually knew about this particular behavior already. There are a lot of experienced browser and XSS researchers that could have found this XSS, but Masato happened to take a hot shower in the right moment and his brain neurons fired and led to those thoughts. I have no clue why, he probably also doesn't really know. This is how creativity works. Maybe a good analogy would be like asking a musician how they came up with a certain melody. A musician also has to spend thousands of hours practicing and gaining experience in music, creating hundreds of shitty songs before they come up with an amazing song. Masato's finding is also a result of years of experience and practice. So don't get frustrated that having done some XSS for a few months or even a handful of years that you don't come up with that. You also have the ability given the time and persistence. Or wait, is there maybe a conspiracy? Is there maybe a secret I didn't tell you? If you dig deeper, you will find connections. What connects Mario from DOM Purify with Gareth, who tweets research, to Sir Darkhead, who works at Google and fixed the Google Search XSS, to AlbinoVax, who is the head of research at Portswicker, aka Burpsuit, who wrote about the no embed thing Gareth found? The conspiracy goes deep. Let me tell you a secret. They have all been part of an old hacker forum called Slackers. Obviously just joking, but it's true. They all have been active on Slackers. That forum doesn't exist anymore, but you can still browse it through the web archive and it's fascinating to read their old conversations. This was a forum where they shared and exchanged exactly this kind of weird JavaScript stuff and challenged each other with short payloads or weird XSS vectors. The reason why all of them are so knowledgeable and able to do this great research and why they have those specific weird ideas to test certain things, it all comes down to having over a decade of experience. They have all joined that forum in 2007 and now it's 2019. So they were at the forefront of exploring XSS when the world hasn't quite realized that XSS is even a thing. So don't feel bad you didn't find that stuff. They are all professionals with over a decade of experience in this specific field. So don't try to rush anything. To get to that level, it requires real dedication and a lot of time.